Well, good morning, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants event. My name is Joe Gorowski, and I'll be your host for today. It has been a very busy start to 2022. We've got over 30 live events for classrooms this month. So I always like to take a quick moment here to share the link. If you head to exploringbytheseat.com, you can find all the events that we have coming up right there. This month, we've had a theme of polar exploration, and next month is one of our favorite months. We kick all the men out, and we host women in science, exploration, adventure, and conservation all month long. So you can find the majority of those events, probably 35 or so events, already up and ready for your classrooms to sign up and register. So check those out, and we hope to see you again in February. Well, as I mentioned, a big theme this month was polar exploration. We've talked to scientists, to explorers, to filmmakers and photographers who visit these incredibly beautiful, biodiverse, remote places of the planet, but then they bring those stories back to us, which is the most important part. Because as we know, we are changing our climate and our polar regions are changing 2 to 3 times faster. They're warming 2 to 3 times faster than the rest of the planet. So we need people visiting these regions and bringing those stories back to us, which is why I absolutely love our connections with Hearts in the Ice, the team of Hilda Strom and Sunava Sorby. They are 2 seasoned polar ambassadors and citizen scientists. Hearts in the Ice was created in 2018 as a platform to engage and connect students, scientists, manufacturers, environmental organizations, and really everyone who cares about the health of our planet, as well as conservation and learning about climate change and ways we can all become part of the solution. So if your classrooms have followed along the last couple of years, Hilda and Sunava spent from September 2019 to May 2021, 18 months living in a remote trapper's cabin called Bumsabu in Svalbard. They were 140 kilometers from their nearest neighbor. Their neighbors were the polar bears. And while they were there, they got to spend time doing all kinds of amazing citizen science projects for organizations around the world. One in particular was observing the auroras. And when you think of polar regions, I think a few things come to mind, like snow and such, but I think auroras is something that would come up within a few kind of thoughts about those polar regions. So I'm going to bring Hilda and Sunava in live with me right now. Let's get them in on this call. Hey, Hilda. Hey, Sunava. How are you?
Hi. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
It's strange to see the two of you apart. Usually we've got the two of you together on camera somewhere. But yes. Hilda, I'm guessing you're joining us from Svalbard today?
I am, from the High Arctic.
Very cool. And Sunava, are you back home in BC?
I'm back home in BC on Vancouver Island. And so Hilda's close to the Northern Lights up there.
Amazing. Well, the magic of technology bringing us together again. I'm going to let you guys take over for a few moments. And then we've got a great expert hanging out with us, Liz, today. I'm really excited to bring her in.
Yeah. Well, it's a pleasure to be here again with you, Joe, and with all of you that following us. And we are so much looking forward to see and listen to what Liz has to say. We had the privilege to work with Liz for 2 winters. And this picture that Joe just brought up here is, this is the favorite time of year for both Sunava and I when we stayed at Bumsabu last winter and the previous winter. And here you can see, this is actually Northern Light coming straight above our head, like showering us. And maybe you can see what it looks like. To me, anyway, it looks like a dancing angel. And this is actually also called Aurora. It's called Corona. So it's coming right above us and that thus has nothing to do with the pandemic that's going on. But isn't it just beautiful? And while we were at Bumsby, we did some time lapse for Liz. And we were also a citizen scientist, or we were rocket citizen scientists, when we capture some pictures for NASA and also for Institute up here in Svalbard, for finding out what is happening when we put some energy and some gases up in the Northern Light. And we took pictures of that in order to understand more about the aurora and the weather patterns. So while we were doing this for LIS, we were outside in complete darkness, and we had to listen for footsteps from polar bears around us. But still, it was an absolutely amazing time and our favorite time of our season. 3 months of complete darkness while we were at Bamsebu each winter. And I also want to thank our partner for this month. We are so pleased to have Handlens Miljøfond on board. And they are the biggest, the largest environmental fund in Norway that aim to reduce plastic waste and also reduce consumers' carrier bags and cleanups. So thank you for that. And I, Alice, I really look forward to listen to you, but I'm sure you, Sunniva, has something to share.
Thanks. And hi, everybody. I'm super happy that you're all on the call today, because this topic is one that never ceases to surprise and amaze. For those of you who weren't following us for the last 2 years, I just want to paint a small picture of where in the world we were for those 19 months. We were closer to the lowest band of the aurora, which is 100 kilometers above. We were closer to that than we were to Longyearbyen, the town that Hilda's in right now. So we had the most amazing light show. We had to put on lots of clothing to get outside, and it never stopped us, actually, from going outside to take time lapse, because it was super fascinating. For you science buffs out there, you should check out the James Webb telescope. I've been following that, and it's just astounding to me the kind of investment and research that we're doing in space. And it's absolutely fascinating and really, really interesting. I'm going to have Joe tee up a little sizzle reel. So because of all the photography that we took up in Svalbard for those close to 2 years, we have a lot of time lapse, we have a lot of video footage and a lot of still photos, and we're working on an IMAX documentary with a company called Imagine Entertainment. So I want Joe to tee that up and sit back. It's just 3 minutes, and then we'll have Liz kick us off. And want to show you this because there's some pretty cool time lapse in there of the aurora. So thanks so much, Joe. So the question is, what did we give up? What did we forfeit to come here?
Well, didn't we give up our whole life?
We gave up our jobs, shopping, showers.
Our family and friends.
Make a wish.
Hey, this is us.
Hi.
And we don't ever go anywhere without Etra, our four-legged friend.
Bjørn rundt veggene, Sunniva.
Today is March 9th, and it's the first time that I see the sun since October. Oh, I have to open up the window. Look at this. There it is.
Pretty cool. Yeah, light is absolutely spectacular that far north. So for those of us who can't get out too much these days, it's nice to be entertained by virtual things like that, I think.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I got to follow along a lot of the journey, but a lot of the time we were on satellite phones, so we didn't have video. We didn't get to see the world outside of the cabin a lot of the time. So it's exciting to see that perspective of the journey that the two of you have been on, and on the big screen. It's going to be pretty exciting.
Very exciting.
Yeah, very.
All right.
So I just want to, Liz, thank you so much for showing up for us today. You're so interesting, and I can't wait for all the kids and the teachers to hear you explain this very mysterious thing up in the sky called the aurora.
All right. Well, let's tuck the two of you backstage temporarily, and let's meet Liz. So Dr. Elizabeth MacDonald works remotely for NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center from her hometown of Walla Walla. She leads a global citizen science project called Aurorasaurus. I'm going to share, I've got that website here queued up so that you can check it out at home or in your classrooms as well. There it is. So it uses citizen science and social media to predict the northern and southern lights. In 2018, she announced the discovery of a new aurora called Steve, and I'm sure we'll talk a little bit about that shortly. So she has been studying the glitter of the Northern Lights for 25 years, and like Hilda and Sunova echoed this as well, it never ceases to amaze her. So let's bring Liz in with us right now. Hey Liz, how are we doing today?
Hi, I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm good. It's great to have you joining us today. We've got a great crew of classrooms joining us from across North America, and we're excited to learn a little bit more about the Northern Lights.
Yes, I'm excited to share that with you.
All right, well, I'll let you take over for a little bit.
Is my screen showing up?
Yeah, let me pop it up. I think we just have to hit that swap display thing again.
Okay.
It looks like I can see the presenter view.
All right, is it good now?
Let me see. It didn't share as nicely for us when we tested. Why don't we just try the screen share again? If you hit stop screen share, we can try it again, and we'll choose that entire screen option and cross our fingers it works better for us this time. Mm-hmm. The magic of technology.
Yeah. We'll try it again.
All right, and if you hit swap display at the top, let's see.
Swap display, how is it going?
Oh, there it goes. Yep, there. We're good.
Okay, great. You can see the picture of the aurora from space, right?
Yep.
Awesome, this is one of my favorite quotes, so I wanted to start with this, from an astronaut about the aurora. And I get to study this burrito of awesomeness and the awesome sauce on top, this awesome green sauce on top. So I'm excited to share more about that with you guys today. And I have a project called Aurorasaurus, And Aurorasaurus has a nice, like the dinosaur, so we have a nice dinosaur logo, but we actually collect observations from volunteers all over the world about the beautiful aurora. So if you're somewhere on Earth where you can see it, or even if you're in space where you could see it, we would love to receive those pictures and study them for science and share that with people. So on the next slide, a little bit about me. I have studied the aurora with rockets and satellites and went to school a long time for that. And I'm excited to connect students and the public with this field that studies the aurora as well. So I wanted to get to know a little bit more about you and see if anybody out there, you can put it in the chat or raise your hand. I guess I can't see it if you've raised your hand, but see if you've seen aurora before, or if you want to see it, if you've maybe tried citizen science before, and also if you love nature. And if you think helping with scientific research might be fun. So yeah, you've definitely got what it takes to be a citizen scientist, and we will talk more about what you could do. So first, to tell you a little bit about what is aurora. So it's this awesome green light that mainly happens up near the magnetic poles of the Earth, both the north and the south, called the northern lights and the southern lights, also called the aurora borealis in the north and the aurora australis in the south. And the beautiful light is the end result of a process that starts at the sun, which is 93 million miles away, and the sun gives us energy. And that energy hits the Earth's magnetic field. And I don't know if you knew, the Earth's magnetic field extends out in space a long way. And it actually protects our planet from radiation from the sun. So most of that energy kind of sweeps on by the Earth's magnetic field. But some of it, some of those particles can trickle in near our space environment. And then they follow these magnetic field lines down to the poles. And I have a little video here that isn't going to play. But yeah, you can just, maybe I can show it with my hands. Sorry, well, maybe I can make it play. Yeah, we'll skip it. But basically, this energy is coming from the sun, and then it hits over here on the left-hand side. The blue lines are the Earth's magnetic field lines. And then it sweeps around into this long, stretched-out tail that we have. And that's where these particles get all stirred up, and they do all kinds of different motions in space. And then they travel down the magnetic field lines at the poles. And then something happens. They hit the atmosphere. And the upper atmosphere, the very edge of space, is quite a bit different than the air that we breathe. And so these particles from space, we call them, they're mostly called electrons, they will hit the very, not very dense particles in the upper air. And that's mostly oxygen. And when it hits the oxygen atoms, it excites those atoms, and then they give off a little bit of light. And they can get excited in different ways, and that actually even causes different colors. So most of the beautiful green of the aurora comes from the oxygen atoms getting excited right around 100 kilometers or 60 miles, which is way up. But also at higher, even higher up, those oxygen molecules can get excited in a little bit different way and cause red light. So that can be seen from like that can be seen from the ground, but also from the space station and places like that. So this is another way to show the way that those colors are produced. So we can see the oxygen atoms glowing red at the highest altitude here, and then glowing green down here. There's also sometimes some beautiful little bits of blue that come out, pink at the very lowest altitude. And those are both from reactions, chemistry with nitrogen as well. And you're about to see all sorts of different pictures of aurora, and they have all different colors because the colors blend. The different colors of light blend, and that's shown in this upper right image where you can add all those colors together and it even comes out pretty white. So let's see, there's many different types of aurora. We're not gonna worry about all these different names today, although I will mention them. So there's different types of arcs. They can be that corona that Hilda showed. They can be like a curtain waving across the sky, or several curtains waving across the sky. If you were out in Alaska or Norway or Northern Canada, really, really late at night, say early in the morning, you also could maybe see this kind of aurora that looks more like an on-off switch, or like a lava lamp or pulsating patches. That's another kind of aurora. It can also be much more quiet and much more of like a diffuse glow on the horizon. And that can be different colors. It happens at different times. The sun does different things all the time. So that's kind of why we need to keep watching. And this last type of aurora is actually brand new, and it's called Steve. And the reason it's called Steve is because citizen scientists actually noticed this, and then they talked to the scientists and said, what is this? And we didn't know what this unusual kind of aurora was. So they called it Steve in the meantime. And that's actually from a movie called Over the Hedge, a kid's movie. But then we've studied this together, and now we've figured out what causes Steve. That's a talk for another day, or maybe you can ask me more questions about that. But now we're gonna talk about what happened with Bombsapu. So, yeah, let's see, up there in Norway, I got to go to Bombsapu. And apologies, I think my computer has frozen. It's coming back. Oh, well, good. That's really good that it's coming back. Can you guys still hear me?
Yeah, we got you back, Liz.
Oh, okay, sorry about that. You know, girl didn't even swirl. So it's just picking up here my computer. But, okay, so we got to go out. Other scientists met, and we had this whole team doing citizen science of different types with Hilda and Sunva. And because they were at Bombsapu for a whole winter, and it's so far north where they are, it's so dark, doing aurora citizen scientist was a really good fit. And in addition, there's a very special type of aurora that you can only see at the very, very pole. And Svalbard is one of the only places where you can see this cusp aurora. So they collected several days of observations of this very rare cusp aurora as well. And this has been studied for a long time, and sometimes it's good to go back and study the history as well. So here we have some pictures of some of the first aurora scientists. And in this case, a man named Carl Stormer from Norway and his assistant, and kind of what it looked like taking some of the very first pictures of aurora outside 100 years ago. And then we have Hilda and Sunava doing the same thing. And actually, it doesn't look all that different because they're keenly up there and watching the aurora. And this also shows how far north Svalbard is. And that's with this little circle on the image at the right here. All right. It's thinking about continuing. Next, I'm going to talk about how Hilda and Sunava became rocket aurora scientists. And citizen scientists generally are in a special place where they might make a discovery. And if you become a citizen scientist and you like looking at something like bugs, your basement or your yard or outside, right where you are, you might find some unusual insect that's never been seen before. So it doesn't matter where you are, there's always something special about the place that you are. And in this case, there was an opportunity to, NASA was launching rockets to study this special cusp aurora way up north. And there were these big collaborations and teamwork and hearts in the ice, because there's so few people up in Svalbard, they were actually in an ideal place to take photos of what this rocket, of the aurora, that the rocket would be studying and sampling all of the particles that are coming down and causing those lights. And one of those rockets is shown in this photo on this page. And then next, let's see, these are some of the observations of actually artificial aurora, which looks really weird. These little glowing blue and green lights are actually lighting up particles in the upper atmosphere that are otherwise invisible. And so a lot of things are happening in the upper atmosphere. And when I described the usual aurora, we only get to see the parts that are like oxygen gets excited, and then when it calms down, it emits a photon of light. But through this rocket, they can release special kinds of tracers that can light up these neutral particles, and then we can learn more about how the space environment is happening. So Hilda and Sunava took amazing photographs outside in the dark under this aurora, and we're so grateful for this, and we are continuing to study these observations. So I'm almost done here. I just wanted to say that they also observed the cusp aurora. They took thousands and thousands, actually more than 40,000 photos of aurora on more than 30 days in just their first winter. So that's really exciting. There's a whole lot of observations that can be studied. And we're going through those now, and it takes a while to go through those. So we're still looking at those. And then I have a last slide here, which has some links for how you can learn more and how you can help with citizen science. And there are students around the world doing that as well. You know, if you're not in a place to see aurora yet, you can participate in other projects, and I can talk more about that. But I'm going to put that slide up, hopefully, any moment now, and then take some questions, because really wanted to get you guys curious about how does this beautiful light happen, and see what more questions you would have about it. There's all kinds of good, all questions are good questions. This is a hard thing to explain. Maybe I will stop sharing while my computer is still slowing down here. How are we,
yeah,
doing,
we can always,
Joe?
Yeah, we can always try the slide closer to the end. And I can definitely share the link for Aurorasaurus again as well to make sure students know where to visit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's bring the rest of the team back in here. Let's bring Hilda. Let's bring Sunava back in. All right. I say it's time for a little Q&A action. We've got a great group of classrooms. They're very engaged in the YouTube chat right now. So we're looking forward to taking some questions. And then we've got some great camera classrooms as well. So like Liz said, anything about the Aurora is fair game. And then, of course, if you have questions about Hilda and Sunava's time in Svalbard at Bumsabu, those questions are fair game as well. So let's get started. I'm going to bring in Mr. Rahim's crew first. They're, looks like they're joining us from Maryland. Let's get them into the call here. How are we doing today, Maryland?
We are great. We are great. We have a couple of questions, if that's okay.
Go for it.
Okay.
My question is, how long does it take before the energized particles from the sun reach Earth's magnetic field?
Okay, so that question, Liz, was how long does it take those particles from the sun to reach the Earth's magnetic field?
Oh, that's a super question. So light goes really fast. Light gets here in like 8 minutes. But these particles actually are not just light, and they take 2 or 3 days to get here from the sun. So we can watch the sun and know that something exciting is going to happen, and maybe the aurora will be visible. But it's still really hard to figure out when that's going to happen.
All right, and we'll grab that second question too.
Okay, Xander and Joseph.
What would happen
to a human if they were in the aurora borealis?
I think we might have lost Liz for a moment. I see the spinning wheel, which is never a good sign, although it does mean the computer is trying to come back in. So maybe we'll have her back with us shortly. Let's just see what happens. Give it a second.
I know that I can't answer that question.
Me neither.
Once we get Liz back. Oh, so it looks like she might have be restarting her computer. We're going to jump to another question while we wait for Liz to come back to us.
Okay.
But I have a feeling the answer to that question is it wouldn't be a good thing. If that magnetic field is protecting us from those rays, I think being in them would probably not be very good for us. But we'll get Liz back in. So thanks for that question, and we'll get it. We'll get it in shortly. All right, let's take a quick look here and see if we can. Oh, here's a good one from online that we'll bring in from Ms. Thompson's crew. Do you remember the first time that you saw the aurora?
Oh, yes. I mean, I have been living on Svalbard since for almost 3 decades. So I remember the first time I saw aurora, and I had heard some, I mean, Norway is a place where, Northern Norway is a place where you can hear or where you can see Northern Lights. So I had heard that you might could hear the Northern Light. So I was listening and I was amazed. But I think some of the most beautiful aurora experience I've ever had up here is together with Sunava. And Sunava, I'm sure you can share some of your feelings around that.
Behind our photos is Bumsabu and the Northern Lights. And you know, the first time I saw the aurora, I was actually in Greenland, but there was nothing like being tucked away in this tiny little trapper's cabin with no light around us, no, you know, natural or nor artificial light, I should say. And then, you know, throwing the door open and then seeing the aurora up there and knowing that the show is going to start. It's just this wave of excitement that that sort of pours through your body, and you grab your gear and you put your clothes on and you just go outside and you set up and you start. I mean, your mouth is open the whole time. It's absolutely spectacular to be under the aurora. We're not looking for it in the north because we're already really far north. So it was absolutely amazing.
All right. Very cool. So Miss Nagel's class just mentioned that they didn't hear the first answer from Liz. So light from the sun takes about 8 minutes to reach the earth, but the particles take about 2 to 3 days to reach the earth. Okay. Let's grab another crew here. Let's go to Mr. Botch's class joining us here in Canada. How are we doing today, boys and girls?
Good.
I'm fine.
How do you make artificial aurora?
Yeah, we should have had Liz here now. That's a very good question. I think we can partly answer that because they sent up this rockets with some containers with the gases. One of them was barium, Sunua. Maybe you remember the other ones. And they were released out in the atmosphere. It was three types of gases that sort of reacted to the Northern Light and also had some interaction there. And we saw them sort of floating over the sky together with the Northern Light that was already there, the cusp aurora that Liz was talking about. And here's Liz, so I'm sure she can tell us more about that.
Liz, we got you back.
I'm so sorry. It's like my internet is in space today.
No, don't worry about it at all. The question that Hilda and Sunova were just kind of touching on was how would you make an artificial aurora? So I think they were curious about that, the rocket launch.
Yeah, so the rocket launch, it's kind of like how you... how fireworks work, you know, like they, in the rocket launch in particular, the rocket is going up and then it emits these little containers, and the little containers have some particles that interact with the air and they cause the normal not visible air to light up. So in that sense, it's a little bit like a firework that goes off and then, you know, when a firework is lit, that's when you can see that reaction like sparkling in the sky. So something like that. Another analogy for how it lights up is I'll stick with that one for now.
All right. So there was a question that came just before we lost you, and that was, what would happen if you were in the aurora, if you could somehow pass through it?
Yeah, so the aurora, if you were an astronaut and you were flying through the aurora, it can be dangerous, but mostly the astronauts actually don't get far enough north or south where the space station orbits. It doesn't go right over the poles. So they don't receive, you know, more than like an X-ray's worth of radiation, which is fairly safe. But they do have, that is something that NASA monitors to keep astronauts safe. It's another reason that we study this whole process because it can have effects also for people flying over the poles as well. But mostly it's very safe and it's something that we monitor.
Okay. Let's bring in Madame Nancy's crew. They're in British Columbia, so maybe not too far away from Sunova today. How are we doing, Madame Nancy and our third graders? Oh, can you grab the mic? We can't hear you.
Oh, sorry there.
That's okay. We got you now.
A student coming to ask a question. There we go.
Why were they named Northern Lights?
I didn't quite hear her.
So why were they named Northern Lights? Is a nice
question. The northern lights, because they mostly happen in the north, that you can see that kind of light. And the Latin name, Aurora Borealis, the root of that word in Latin, refers to the northern regions. So, and similarly for the southern lights, it's Aurora Australis, like Australia, so meaning in the south.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
Great All question. Right.
Very cool. Let's jump to another live classroom here. We're going to go to Mrs. Rob's crew are in Ottawa. Let's bring them live in with us right now. There they are. Here they come. Hey, Ottawa.
Oh my gosh. Hi there. Sorry. Sorry. We joined a little bit late and we added a few of our questions to the chat, Joe. I hope you can. We're just having lunch, so we're just catching the end of your presentation.
Sure. Why don't I pick one here from the chat?
Yeah, please, if you don't mind. They were curious about actually when people started to actually understand that the Northern Lights were not, you know, a mystery. It wasn't magic. How did they actually, and when and who actually figured out that it was a scientific, you know, phenomenon? Please. Thank you. Say hi.
Yeah, that's a great question as well. Thank you for that. So I mentioned earlier that even 100 years ago, we were starting to be able to photograph the Northern Lights. And this is something that some of our citizen scientists do today. When you photograph the Northern Lights from multiple locations, you can do some math, some geometry, and get the height of the aurora. And so once they were able to get the height, they really understood how, you know, more about what the composition was of the upper atmosphere, and started to like piece together the connection to events on the sun as well. There was a really, really huge event that caused aurora as far south as like Bermuda in 1859. And that one, astronomers actually observed the origin of that flare on the sun. They happened to be observing it. And so there was a connection there as well. So, you know, for many hundreds of years, we've started to build up some knowledge there. And now when we can go to space, you can actually directly measure the particles that follow the Earth's magnetic field lines and figure out a lot more about what they're made of, how fast they're going, what direction they're going. And even though space is really, really large, we can then piece together even more. So.
All right. Great questions from our students so far today. Yeah. We're going to go south. We're going to head to Alabama. We have some fifth graders hanging out with us. How are we doing today?
Hi.
They look excited.
Hey, we are great today. Thanks for having us. Our student has a question for you.
Why are auroras different colors when they're excited in different ways?
Yeah, the aurora is different colors when it's excited in different ways.
And
yeah.
she wanted to know why.
Why?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's a really good question. It gets really complicated. But it has to do with the how many particles there are in the upper atmosphere at the edge of space. And so we think about the air we breathe. There's a whole lot of particles. The air is really thick, but at the edge of space, it starts to get less and less thick. There's only a few particles in a little area. And so when you hit those particles, you're making a collision, and the collisions work differently depending on how many there are. So at the really highest altitudes, there's so few particles that you can get that red light because that first collision happened, and then there were no more collisions because there's no more particles up there. And so that red light actually takes like 2 minutes to come out. And that's the reason why you don't get the red light as much lower down, because you get more collisions and it doesn't have 2 minutes to wait around for that
red photon to be able to come out. I don't know if that that totally made sense, but it's a really complicated question. So I tried to answer it.
All right. There are so many questions about Aurora. I can see that they're really into it today. The students really want to know more. And I think, you know, a lot of that is because it's something you hear about or you see on TV, in books, and a lot haven't been able to observe them yet. So hopefully they get to sometime in the future. But Miss Dion has a great question here. Her class is wondering, do other planets experience the aurora?
Yes, they do. Yeah. And other planets have magnetic fields. They can be different. So Earth has just a north and a south magnetic field, but other planets can have like a north, a south, an east, and a west magnetic field. And then the shape of that magnetic field looks totally different, and the particles do different things. So they have, how would the aurora look like on those other planets? And then there's like Jupiter, which has this huge magnetic field because Jupiter's really big. Its magnetic field is really strong. And then, you know, some of the planets like Saturn have moons that are moving around in the magnetic field with volcanoes. And I'm just giving you a flavor for all over the solar system. You can look up what kind of aurora there might be. But the short answer is yes, there are different kinds of aurora at most of the other planets.
All right. I'm going to bring Miss Rob's class in again. There they are. Give them a big wave.
And
a great question. There. Hey, guys. I wanted to bring you back in because you put a great question back in the chat here for Hilda and Sunava. And they're wondering, would you go back and do the Trapper's Cabin experience again?
In a heartbeat. Absolutely. I mean, I miss Bamsebu and the life at Bamsebu, I think every day, more or less. I'm back in Longyearbyen, back into people and societies and the busy wheel, the hamster wheel. Everything we did at Bamsebu had a purpose. We were very lonely, the two of us. And we had 3 months of complete darkness, but then again, we had another light and we had polar bears around us and reindeers. But the short answer, and we didn't have Netflix or running water or insulated hut or I don't know. We didn't have much, but we had a lot of purpose. What about you, Sunava?
It's a really interesting question. And, you know, when we went there the first time, it was supposed to be 9 months. And as you all know, it ended up being closer to 19 months because of COVID, and we couldn't get a pickup. We were really remote. And so it was not an easy decision for both of us to decide to go back for the second year. But when we finally made that decision, it was a really good move on our part. And so, yeah, I would agree that absolutely I would go back. You know, we really don't need to have a shower. We went, 8-9 months without a shower the first time. There might be overrated to have them every day. But we are planning an expedition in the Canadian Arctic, actually, next at the end of this year. And we won't be living like we did at Bamsebu, but what we're trying to do is still conduct citizen science in the Canadian Arctic using the similar projects that we were doing in Svalbard. But our goal with this project is to take all of the tools and the knowledge that we gained from, you know, capturing aurora and how to work the camera and how to take ice core samples and all of that, and hand that to the community and have them be the citizen scientists, so we can actually take indigenous knowledge, because they're living on the land with the land and have been for, you know, forever, and have them actually be the ones taking their understanding of what their observations have been, and then the science, and build a bridge between that, and then share stories from the north. So we're going back to do another expedition, but it won't be in Svalbard. Did we lose Joe?
Oh, wow.
Oh, that's a first.
Yeah.
Well, that's we could, who wants to be the host?
I could answer a couple more questions that I see in the chat for the moment.
Please.
Since you all covered for me. So Mr. Bashia's grade four class has two really good questions here. Well, questions that I can easily answer. Why are the Northern Lights better known than the Southern Lights? And so, you know, one reason for that might be that there's actually more land in the northern regions. So all across Northern Canada and North America, for instance, and Russia and Scandinavia as well. So there's just more land where you can see the Northern Lights. But also, if we had any classrooms from the Southern Hemisphere here, I think they might not think that the Northern Lights are better known than the Southern Lights. So it's all a matter of perspective as well. And it looks like Joe is coming back. The other question is, what training does it take to be a scientist studying the aurora? And so there is a variety of the field that I'm in is called different things, but I studied physics, and people also study astronomy, but it's usually called physics or plasma physics or space physics or geophysics for the Earth. But there's also some aerospace engineering with all the satellites and all of that as well. So. Hi, Joe.
He's back.
Hi. We are having all kinds of connectivity fun today.
I think, yeah, there's magnetism all around.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was in suspense when I lost you. You were about to say if you'd go back to the cabin, and I bet you said yes.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Very cool. Well, we can still take a couple more questions. I'm just going to grab one here from the chat. This is from a student joining us in Quebec, and they're wondering, what were the temperatures like when you were outside watching the auroras?
Oh, yeah, that could vary, but it could easily be minus 30 degrees Celsius, which is how much in Fahrenheit, you know? We had to dress up really, really warm, and we had to protect ourselves, especially the fingers, and I tend to have my nose to the very cold camera, so it sort of got stuck a few times. And when you have this fantastic experience, you forget that you freeze or that you are really cold. But yes, it was very cold.
The hard thing too were batteries for the camera, so we always had a few stuck, you know, inside our jacket, and we'd have to swap out the batteries. So especially when we're doing time lapse, it's not for the faint of heart, I must say.
Yeah, there's so many extremely dedicated aurora photographers out there. They are so passionate. They go out in all temperatures. It's really great. I also wanted to recognize, I saw briefly earlier, we had some like top citizen scientists for Aurorasaurus from Norway in the chat. I think his name is Kato. It went by really fast, but wanted to say hi.
Cool. So. Fantastic.
All right. Very cool. Well, I think at this stage, it's time to give a huge shout out to our classrooms who joined us live via YouTube, sent us in those amazing questions via the chat. Of course, to our camera classrooms, it's always great to see the students and hear their questions. And there were lots today. I think we could have gone on for another hour or two and they still would have kept coming. I do want to share a few more links in the chat. Of course, take some time and visit Aurorasaurus. And if you are lucky enough to be in a spot where you do get to see them, please take some photos and send them in and be citizen scientists yourself. So we'll share that one more time. I want to share the link to heartsintheice.com. Take some time, visit the website, learn more about the incredible work that Hilda and Sunova have been doing to bring so many people together and keep the conversation going around climate change and look for solutions. And then I want to share this website here too. If you want to check out the past events that we've done with Hearts in the Ice, if you want to check out some cool education resources, some beautiful story maps, sharing some of the work from the auroras and polar bears and citizen science, you can find that all there.
And Joe, I just want to mention really briefly a little bit of a plug. our book is available on Amazon now. It's called Hearts in the Ice. And we do write about our science, our citizen science projects in there. So if anyone's keen to learn a little bit more about, you know, equipment we used and what we did, then you should grab a copy.
All right. Excellent. Well, Hilda Sinova, as per usual, always great to see you. Liz, I think we've been in 3 or 4 of these events together so far. So it's always great to hear the work that you're doing and bringing so many people into the world of science and looking up at that glittery show in the sky. So thank you so much for sharing that with us today.
My pleasure. Thank you.
All right.
And thanks to all the kids out there, and stay curious, and maybe you can become a citizen science as Sunova and I, and go outside. Maybe if you're lucky, I mean, very often the Northern Light can go very far south on these very specific occasions. Otherwise, maybe you can travel a little bit further north and stay up during night and look at some of the aurora apps. Maybe you'll able to catch some picture of it.
All right.
To put on your bucket list for sure.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Thank you, everybody.
All right. Have a great rest of the week, everybody. And we'll see you again soon. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.